Hello, everyone. This is the 13th Crusader. Thank you for tuning in to a brand new episode of The Capes, the comics and pop culture entertainment syndicate. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to a brand new episode of The Capes. I am the 13th Crusader. David Howard is not with us today, which means that Shawn Warner has the unfortunate and unenviable task of hanging out with me on this podcast. How are you doing, Shawn?
Hey, I love being here. Greetings, Earthlings.
There you go. The trademark greeting from Shawn. Fantastic.
I'm gonna market it.
You should. I just want to take a quick moment to thank all you listeners who are tuning in. If this is your first time listening, definitely go back on the Undercover Capes Podcast Network and tune into the first two episodes that we've launched. We're here for our third podcast. And again, if this is the third time you're hearing us, thank you for joining us again. I also want to give a quick shout out to Gary Summers of the Northeast Comic Con, a recent Comic Con that I attended in New England. As always, a phenomenal show. And another shout to Joe St. Pierre, who has done, we've lost count of how many Spider-Man books he's worked on. And he does have a variant cover for Green Lantern 5 that's still available at your finer comic book retailers. So definitely pick it up. Definitely a must have. So shout out to you guys.
Big talent.
And, oh, yeah. Absolutely. Absolutely. I always have a blast with Joe. There's no doubt about that. So with that being said, we're going to start off this podcast with a poll that we put out there. And the poll is going to center on our first topic for this podcast. It's going to surround Joe Sinnott, the longtime comic book artist and inker, primarily for Marvel. And the question was as follows. After working in comics for nearly 70 years, legendary comic book artist and inker Joe Sinnott announced that he will be retiring. 70 years.
92 years old.
It's a feat in itself.
Yeah.
Of the Marvel titles listed, which one do you think contains his best work and the choices were Fantastic Four, Avengers, Defenders, and Thor? All of them were the first volume, and it was an overwhelming response for Fantastic Four Volume 1. And what I can say about that quickly, that was during the Jack Kirby time.
Absolutely.
This is a guy that worked, hand in hand with Jack Kirby.
Yes.
And what I find so interesting in looking back at the career that Joe Sinnott had, the first time he was on Fantastic Four with Jack Kirby was for the first appearance of Dr. Doom.
Dr. Doom, yep.
And after that, he never worked on Fantastic Four again until later on in the run.
Yeah.
Towards the tail end of Jack Kirby's run on Fantastic Four. And because he was committed to another project. And mm-hmm. like, this guy is tied to the first Doom, the first Surfer, the first Panther, Galactus. I mean, these are just, household names in the realm of Fantastic Four.
Yes.
And it's just such an amazing thing. At that time, when he was given Fantastic Four 5, he's like, oh, yeah, you know what? I'll do this issue, but I got another project. Look at it today. From today's perspective, it's like, are you kidding me?
and the thing that was so great about him is, he started out doing some pencils at Atlas, before it was Marvel, and right. he was in the war. So when he came back, he like a lot of guys, used the GI Bill to go into the cartooning school, and he he was like a sought after guy to do these. There really weren't any superhero comics at the time. It was war, westerns, and romance. And, you know, he was making $20 a week, which at the time was like, you know, phenomenal money. And I mean, the amount of pages that he started to turn in, his page rate became $20 a page. So, you know, when he was getting all of these, the inking jobs that came in, it was like he overshadowed the work he was doing as a penciler and became more prolific as an inker.
Right. And it's so funny that you mentioned that, because in talking with artists and inkers today, some of them will tell you that it's like an inker is not as how can I put this gently, as prolific as it maybe once was, or not held in that high of a regard. You know, I don't know. I beg to differ, because I've always been of the type that, listen, it takes a team to create a book.
Definitely.
And there are inkers out there that make a considerable difference, or very notable difference, in some of, even some of the best pencilers.
Yeah.
You know, and Joe Sinnott is just, when I think inker, it's always been Joe Sinnott.
Absolutely.
He's the first guy that comes to mind.
Yeah, and you know, he was like the all of the pencilers wanted to work with him, you know. And the reason why he was getting more pay than some of the other guys at in his early career, like at Atlas, is because he could pencil, ink his own stuff. You know, he'd do the pencils and ink his own stuff. So, you know, he's getting essentially two paychecks at the time. And, you know, when they cut his pay rate back to, at the time, I think he was making like $43, and they cut it back to $21, and he didn't even mind, because he was like, this is more money than I ever thought I'd make, you know? Right. So, I mean, in that respect, you know, he was a humble guy. I mean, I don't mean to talk about him like he's deceased. He's still with us, but I'm saying, you know, since he's retired, and he's always, anybody who's ever met him says, you know, he's such a humble guy. And you don't even get the sense that this is a guy who has done so much. And like you said, he's synonymous as an inker. He's the first one that pops into your head. And when certain pencilers, you know, that have worked with one inker predominantly throughout, like you think of Arthur Adams, and you think of Terry Austin, you know, but he has inked Jack Kirby, you know, John Byrne, he's the inker, bar none, he's the guy.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, the fact that he's been doing this for almost 70 years, I mean, this guy has been around since there was a 10th Crusader. So I mean, it's incredible. My dad wasn't even born. My parents weren't even born. It's just mind-boggling to think of how long of a career he's had. If you think about it, this is a guy that whose career really spanned from the towards the tail end of the golden age of comic books.
Absolutely.
And if you just put that in perspective, and you just think of the time that's elapsed from the edge of the golden age all the way through now, with the struggles comic books had, the comics code going darker and what have you, it is just, I don't know if anybody could ever match that.
No, he's seen the birth of Marvel till the birth and of the cinematic universe. He's seen the narrative from the beginning, and he's had a hand in it, you know. Like you said, the Fantastic Four, just that single issue that he did, that's one of the most iconic issues in the run. But when you get into the meat of his inking on Kirby, the First Surfer, First Galactus, Inhumans, these huge, basically setting up the cosmic corner of the Marvel universe as we know it. That was when the seeds were planted, and certainly laid the groundwork for what Jim Starlin did later, right. You know, with Thanos and Adam Warlock. And, you know, I mean, just think if Kirby and Sinnott hadn't done what they did, you know, the things that came after it, the Marvel Cinematic Universe, you know, that exists right now would be totally different. And even the Marvel Universe in the comics would be so different.
Yeah, and honestly, you know, Jack Kirby, obviously, probably the penultimate career in comics, but, you know, when you're talking Jack Kirby, you know, everyone's going to say, oh, Jack Kirby, if we just take it to the Marvel side, Jack Kirby and Stanley and Jack Kirby. Okay. But to me, it's a crime in the comic book community if you do not mention Joe Sinnott.
I agree.
Along with Jack Kirby.
I agree. And, you know, they did hundreds and hundreds of pages together, and I believe they only met a handful of times. He mainly spoke to him over the phone and, you know, got the pages from the Marvel office, and then he'd ink them and turn them back in. But he said they met at one particular convention. He said they had a great time, but, you know, and they were friendly, but they didn't meet a lot in person. They did, you know, they did most of their stuff through the Marvel office.
Right, and that's even more of a phenomenal accomplishment. Yes. Could you imagine?
Right.
If the edge of the golden age was in today's era with all the technology available.
Oh, you know, yeah.
FaceTiming each other. Hey, I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. Could you just imagine?
Right. I mean, here, you know, he's getting these pages from Jack Kirby and just saying, you know, just do your thing, Joe. That's a crazy amount of trust. And it's like a collaboration where, you know, Kirby worked his magic on the blank page. But then Joe, you know, he had to basically complete Jack's vision, you know. Mm-hmm. And like you said earlier, you know, a good anchor is going to pull all the best out of a penciler. A bad anchor is going to muddy up those lines. He's, you know what I mean? It's right. I've seen bad anchors on a great penciler, and then I've seen the same page done by a great anchor, and the difference is like night and day.
Yeah, I mean, and on the subject of anchors, you know, again, I've spoken with many artists plenty of times, and some of them that primarily ink feel like they're underrated or underappreciated.
They're the unsung heroes, in my opinion.
Absolutely. And, you know, to think of inkers other than Joe Sinnott, I think of Claus Janssen.
One of my absolute favorites. I love that guy. Especially
he can draw. There's no doubt he can draw.
Oh, yeah. His inks on Frank Miller and on Bill Sienkiewicz, I mean, that was pure magic.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And I am a fan of Brett Booth, but I feel, you know, the guy's pencils are just legendary already.
Yeah, yeah.
But I feel like Norm Rapman's inking on Brett Booth art, it's just peanut butter and jelly when I see it.
And I feel that way about, like I said, Arthur Adams and Terry Austin. I mean, those guys, I mean, they worked hand in glove together. And for me, Arthur Adams was the first guy who brought that, you know, millions of interior lines and brought that. When the first time I read the Long Shot miniseries, I actually got it on the rack when I was a kid, and I was like, who is this guy? You know? And unfortunately, you know, he didn't turn the pages out as fast as he needed to really reach that upper echelon status. But the people that know his work, you know, if you're in the know, you know Arthur Adams' work just by looking at it. Nobody captures that super detailed interior line work the way he does.
I love his X-Men work. There's no doubt about it.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I even got
for both of them. Yeah.
His Monkey Man and O'Brien run.
That's something you don't hear every day.
No.
But on the subject of Joe Sinnott, let's not forget about his long time work and dedication on the Spider-Man comic strip.
Yeah. Oh, yes, yes. Absolutely. That is a legacy in itself, you know.
Right.
And I think that's like something that needs a larger audience. You know, I mean, it's for the amount of time that it's been available, I think it's definitely underappreciated. But again, agreed. If you're in the know and you seek it out, it's just an amazing thing. And the storytelling, the sequential art storytelling that goes on in that, you know, 3-4 panels that you get at a time, is just unbelievable.
Right. And I don't know. I mean, I don't create comic strips, but I could only imagine that trying to convey a story with art with the least amount of panels must be incredibly difficult.
Absolutely. Yeah. I think it's no small feat when you can tell a story. You know, a lot of the times we think of the comic strips as like Dilbert and stuff like that.
Right.
But when you take a more serious, like the Batman dailies, the Spider-Man, the Prince Valiant, when you can tell stories on a complex level in that short of a space and keep people's attention from, you know, sometimes it was week to week. I mean, the Spider-Man ran in the dailies, but, you know, even that, you know, you miss one, you miss a chunk, but it was always enough to pull you back in the way he, you know, with his, his storytelling was so precise.
Right. It's not every day you wake up and say, you know what, I'm going to read a comic strip. You just don't hear that in this day and age.
No, there's too many things competing for our entertainment dollar, you know, and newspapers, unfortunately, are like fossils, you know. I remember when I was a kid, you know, just in Baltimore, we had the News American, the Sun paper, and some smaller ones, you know, and they systematically just boom, one's gone, the other's gone, you know. And, you know, I know we still have the Sun, but I don't see, you know, people like kids out on their bikes delivering papers like they used to. And, you know, people are like, oh, I can just look on the internet when I get up in the morning. And, you know, unfortunately, a comic strip kind of, you know, you want to read it in the newspaper. You know, you want to see that newsprint. And especially like with Joe Sinnott, like his artwork really didn't need to be colored. You know, it didn't, of course that, you know, that brought another dimension to his work, but his inking brought so much depth and dimension to the images already that I liked looking at his stuff uncolored, you know, like the Spider-Man, you know.
Right. I mean, he must be a treasure trove of comic book information and experiences.
Can you imagine the story? I mean, like I said, his story starts at the beginning.
Right. Absolute Hall of Famer when in the world of comic books, Joe Sinnott. Yes. Congratulations again on a 70. I can't imagine working 1 year. Imagine 70. I mean, it's just an incredible accomplishment.
Right. I imagine he comes back from fighting in a war and has this amazing career as an artist, you know?
Right. I mean, in comic books.
Right, he's an American treasure, man. And you know what? I remember one thing that I read a long time ago about him. When they asked him to do the war comics, he said, "I don't have to write them; I lived them. I did, you know, I did these things. All I have to do is draw it." You know,
right.
He was going from memory, you know.
So, for you listeners out there, definitely, if you have no idea who we're talking about, but you know who Jack Kirby is, chances are, the guy behind the inks was Joe Sinnott.
Absolutely. And if you don't know him, definitely Google that name. And I'm sure you will have seen some of that artwork before. And now you can fully appreciate one of the integral parts of the team that brought it to you.
Right. And so now let's talk about some recent changes, creative changes.
Okay.
Yeah, I definitely want to bring up Valiant Comics, okay? So, independent comic book company. They've done a pretty good job since their resurrection, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
The newer iteration, you know, better stories, much higher quality.
Oh, yeah.
So Tim Seeley, Brett Booth, Tina Howard has been there. Heather Renatos, again, if I'm butchering the names, please forgive me. She joined on as an editor. So Valiant is making some changes, and I think they're going to be great changes. Adding Brett Booth to the stable to draw Bloodshot.
That's one I'm looking forward to.
Yeah, he is. I hold him in very high regard with his artwork. The pencils are just precision. It just absolute sharpness.
Yeah,
when it comes to his pencils.
He was one of the big guys to come out of, you know, the some of the Image titles that he worked on, and you know, especially some of the DC titles. He has a big house style. You know, and I think that's going to work great on Bloodshot.
Right.
I've been reading Bloodshot since way back in, the first time Valiant popped onto the scene. Mm-hmm. And I liked it. But I tell you, Matt Kent is doing something special. And when you have Matt Kent and Jeff Lemire,
right,
behind a lot of the a lot of the things that are going on with Valiant, and you have Vin Diesel working putting Bloodshot on the big screen, mm-hmm, and taking such a huge interest in the source material, you cannot lose when you have that kind of cohesion. Marvel has proved it time and again. When you have people that are interested in these characters, and I mean interested in seeing the best iteration of them put forth to tell the story, you get great results. And I think Valiant has taken that to heart, and I think we're going to see some big things from them.
Absolutely. And for you comic book readers out there, you know, don't disregard Valiant Comics. I can tell you that, I don't know, I was allergic to to independent comic books for a time.
I know what you mean.
You know, it was always big two, and I got to get the next big story. This creator is on this, and oh wait, he's jumping to DC or vice versa to Marvel.
Yes.
Don't take Valiant for granted. They really come out with some very high quality stories.
Yes.
And what impresses me the most with Valiant Comics in general is their ability to take a huge story, but yet give it to you in 4 issues. That is extremely impressive. So just like we were talking about Joe Sinnott conveying a story in just 2 or 3 panels, maybe 4 at best, Valiant to me has mastered the 4-issue limited series.
I can see that. And on the flip side of that, the long-running narrative, like in Exo Man of War, that book has been consistently one of the best books on the rack since number one of this current run.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the artwork, the covers are so, I mean, and they do 3 and 4 variants for each issue, and they're all top notch, high quality covers with great artists. You don't see any like chromium or glow in the dark or die cut gimmick covers. This is just strong artwork. Mm-hmm. Most of them are painted, and the interior art has been, the story has been engrossing, the art has been mind-blowing. And I go back to when Bart Sears was doing Exo, and I love his artwork, and I think that most of the guys that have come on Exo have taken something from Bart Sears and integrated it into their art, and that character has been so strong. The mythology, the history of that character, to me, it's as good as Adam Warlock and some of the Marvel characters that are in the same vein in the space opera type stuff. Valiant to me is a company that could explode onto the scene at any time, just given the right circumstances. Like if the Bloodshot film gets a good buzz going, watch out for Valiant, because they're going to be pulling big talent, and they're going to be putting out good stories, great art.
Yeah, I mean, everything's baseball for me too, as well as comic books, and you know, to me, Valiant's a player that will be called up to the big leagues. It's only a matter of time if they're not there already.
Yeah, I agree. I think people are, and it's not like I'm saying the comic fans. I think the industry is sleeping on them. You know what
Absolutely.
I mean? And I think that when the Valiant Universe was, you know, they're talking about scooping it up and making this the next big, you know, everything's a movie. But if you get ahead of yourself and you say, all right, we're going to buy up all these properties and then we're going to make movies, but you neglect the source material, you're not going to make good movies. And even if you do, people aren't going to care about them because they're like, oh, that's those crappy comic books. You know, you've got to put quality source material out. And I think that's what Valiant is doing. You know, I mean, same Image does it. I think Image is one of those companies that is more concerned with the comics, and if the TV shows and the movies follow, that's fine. But they're constantly putting out quality comic books, and a lot they're getting a lot of guys that work at the big two to do their creator own stuff at Image. And I think Valiant is, no pun intended, but they're the dark horse in the race, you know.
Dark Horse Comic Books, a podcast for another day. But definitely, Valiant is definitely, don't sleep on them. That's for sure. No. That's for sure. So I'm going to be a very lazy host. I'm going to let Sean explain to your listeners another recent announcement to a stable change at Marvel.
Take it away, Sean. Okay, thank you. This is a big one. Jonathan Hickman, who was a huge writer in the Marvel echelon of writers, the upper echelon, I should say. He's on par with your Grant Morrisons and your Chris Claremonts. He did a great, phenomenal run on Fantastic Four. His work with Avengers had set the ground rules for what followed in the cinematic universe. The Black Order that we saw in the Avengers movie, that's all Hickman. And he is not only coming back to Marvel, but he is coming to the X-Men titles. He is going to be doing two X-Men books. Both of them are going to be on a weekly schedule, one after the other, so they're not going to both come out the same week. And I, for one, cannot wait for this. I've been missing Jonathan Hickman for a long time, East of West, and you know, the books that he's been doing, they just don't come out fast enough. And I need Hickman on a big book like X-Men. I mean, that fits the bill perfectly. There was talk of him doing a Legion of Superheroes book at DC. And
oh, please, God, please.
I would have definitely have loved that. But this I'll take it. Hickman, X-Men, I can deal with that.
You got my full attention. X-Men and Legion of Superheroes. I mean, you know, the one thing I could say about X-Men titles, okay? You know, when I was growing up, one of my cousins, you know, he's older than me. Again, I'm not going to date myself, but I will say he is much older than me. He collected X-Men for me. he had issue 1, 2, 3 sequential. Okay? He never let me hold number 1. But he let me hold and read number 2 and on until the issue 66. He had a lot of these. And I say had because he sold them eventually, and yes, I called him an idiot, whatever. But, you know, I won't dig into that too much. Maybe one of these days I'll shout him out and call him an idiot officially. But, you know, it was just one X-Men title for a long time. When New Mutants came out, it was like, whoa, we're going to get two X-books now.
Yes.
And where we have come since the mid-80s, since that two issues or two titles, you need a GPS to follow which X-Men book to read in whatever order. So there have been great X-Men stories, phenomenal X-Men stories. There's no doubt. There's no question. You know, they have a plethora of heroes and villains. Mm-hmm. They have both of them interacting with each other, having to work together reluctantly or maybe on purpose. love stories, villain, and, you know, they've done so much stuff and introduce and continuing to introduce new characters.
Yes.
Now, with what you're saying, you know, to me, I think the struggle with X-Men may have been that it's stretched too much. But
yeah.
It sounds like Hickman's going to just rein it all in.
Yeah, well, he's doing, like I said, two titles. It's going to be House of X and Powers of X. Mm-hmm. And like I said, they're going to be alternating weekly titles, but on an alternating schedule. I think, you know, that aspect, it's going to be hard to, you know, get one and not get the other. I think this is going to be a story that runs through, you know, a week to week basis. And you've got, I know Pepe LaRaza is going to be on one. And I think, RB Silva will be on the other.
Mm-hmm.
And you have, I mean, those are like young gun artists, but they've already got such a huge, body of work. And LaRaza, these guys have that new style that I know a lot of people are like saying, oh, the South American artists, Italian artists, you know, Sara Pacelli, all these people, you know, when is that going to, you know, waiting for the next thing. But these guys and these people are the next thing. And Jonathan Hickman, I think, has recognized these kind of artists early on. And he's always worked with you know, guys like that Avengers, those Avengers titles, besides when Bendis was doing like the new Avengers, Mighty Avengers and stuff, I think Hickman brought that science fiction vibe to the Avengers that opened it up.
Agreed.
To that cosmic element to bring in the Guardians of the Galaxy, to bring in, you know, Thanos and really make that such a fertile landscape to tell these great, basically space opera type stories, you know. And Hickman brings in that highbrow sci-fi, not right. The kind of like, you know, I'm a Star Trek guy, but let's say original series was kind of basically what Gene Roddenberry wanted, was, you know, like a wagon train in space, and that's what we got, you know. It dealt right. with big issues and everything, but you know, Hickman gets in there and he brings in like an Isaac Asimov kind of sci-fi to it, you know, the stuff that you can just dig into with both hands and go as deep as you want to go.
Yeah, and for many years, I've always considered the cosmic side of comic books kind of overlooked. Now,
yeah.
I mean, look at the Avengers movies out there now. You know, Guardians of the Galaxy,
yeah.
Thanos, you know, even Thor to a degree yeah. is cosmic, and science
oh, totally.
And mythology all roll into one.
Yeah,
so
I mean,
definitely don't snooze on cosmic comic book stories. And when you mentioned, you know, a potential Legion of Superheroes run, I've been waiting for years.
Yeah,
for a new Legion of Superheroes run.
I know.
It's almost to the point where I'm desperate. I don't care who is doing it; just freaking do it. Somebody, for God's sake, just, let's get a Legion run going.
When those rumors started circulating about Hickman, it looked like that was really going to happen, you know, like DC was going to scoop him up. We were going to get a Legion book. I couldn't have been more excited, you know, and I'm a little disappointed, but maybe it'll happen after this. But right now I'm really stoked to see, not that I'm not into Kelly Thompson and the guys that are writing Uncanny right now. It's been good, you know, but I just think that Hickman's going to bring in that highbrow sci-fi, and I think we're going to get another Avengers level book where every run feels like an event, you know, and Hickman does that, you know.
With a team like the X-Men and the amount of characters they have and the amount of team stories they have together and solo stories, the possibilities are endless. So yep. In the right hands with any of the X-Men titles or all of them or whatever, if they want to just consolidate them all one day, which I'm hoping for.
Yeah.
So it's not as difficult and much more affordable.
Yeah.
Definitely, I would welcome that. You know, definitely no critique to anybody that's working on the current X-Men books or stories. Definitely not. But, you know, there's nothing wrong with breathing a little bit of fresh air
mm-hmm.
into a team as critical as the X-Men are for Marvel.
Well, and I mean, look, for a while, you know, the Fantastic Four went away, you know, and the X-Men, for the most part, weren't a part of the Marvel landscape, all because of these petty licensing deals that, you know, rich people want in the money grab, you know, and we, the fans that have loved these characters and have been such a huge part of our lives and such a huge part of the pop culture zeitgeist at large, mm-hmm. you know, we were the ones who suffered, you know, not the guys in the ivory towers and the suits. You know, we wanted X-Men stories. We wanted Fantastic Four stories. And, you know, the X-Men stories that we get, that we got at that time, you know, the brand was, like you said, it was diluted. You know what I mean? It was
right.
It was watered down. You had X-Force over here. You had X-Factor over here.
Too many Phoenix stories.
Yeah.
And I love Phoenix.
Me too.
Really, absolutely adore the character, but way too many.
Yeah.
And
I think right now what we're seeing is kind of a last ditch effort with that, with the Age of X-Men and the Young Cable and all these miniseries. You know, it's just too many miniseries for the average person to consume all the stories financially. It's a burden. And I think Marvel, I mean, I was talking with somebody on Facebook about the you know, how some comic book fans have this obsessive completist side. And when you put 34 variant covers on a book, you know you're going to create this kind of, you know, not a feeding frenzy, but you're going to drive prices up on books that only have a different cover. And you're going to sell the same book to a loyal fan 34 times.
Now, yeah, I mean that's crazy. That's almost double the amount of triple the amount of 13. Definitely not cool. Right. Quickly, Scott, hand me Cerebro so I can put this reading order together for our own book.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. I don't know, but definitely welcome news in the world of the X-Men and DC. If you're listening again, please, please, can you find anyone that's willing to take up Legion of Superheroes?
Yes.
It's nice that we're getting a little bit of teases here and there with Doomsday Clock.
Yeah.
But please, it's long overdue.
Yes. Hey, Grant Morrison's only doing Green Lantern right now. That man can handle another book. Get him on a Legion book right now.
Hey, you know what? If there's no one else that's available, give us a call. How's that?
Absolutely. Hey, I'm not busy.
So, speaking of big money deals, let's kick things over to the cinematic universe.
Okay.
For the DC end.
So, oh, yes.
Recently, Ezra Miller, the actor that plays the Flash on the
Barry
Justice
Allen.
League.
Yep.
Barry Allen, the Barry Allen version of the Flash, said that, hey, you know what? I'm going to write my own script.
Yeah.
Grant Morrison's going to help me. And we're going to give you a different Flash.
Mm-hmm.
So what do you think about that? Because his initial thought process is, I want a little more serious Flash character on screen.
Yeah. You know, from what I heard, the script that was on the table right now was basically Back to the Future with superheroes. That is not necessarily a bad thing. But, you know, I agree with Ezra Miller. I mean, the Flash is a perfect character to introduce some humor. You know, he can
agreed,
be lighthearted
right.
at times. But even if you look at the Flash in the CW universe, it's not all that lighthearted.
He's,
you know, there's some serious storytelling going on. I mean, with the dark matter and you know, I mean, Barry's parents, one went to prison and one was murdered, right? You know, so it's a dark origin story. So to totally, reach in and abstract all of the darkness from the story, I think you do the character an injustice.
Agreed.
But at the same time, you know, he has a great rogues gallery where you could have some, and Ezra Miller did this in, you know, the very few times we got to see him handle the character on screen. He obviously brought like a kind of offbeat, comedic sensibility to it. But I agree with him that you don't want to neuter the character completely and turn him into a joke. You want this character to have some bravado and to have some dark, dramatic elements to the narrative. And Grant Morrison is a perfect guy to do it.
I absolutely agree with his intention. Mm-hmm. But my initial thoughts are that with any character that you portray on screen, or for anyone who writes a character for an actor to portray, mm-hmm. you need to have balance.
Yes.
And something that you said earlier in the podcast about going back to the source material is absolutely crucial. And
yes.
In the Justice League movie, to me, yeah, Ezra Miller played Flash, Barry Allen Flash. Mm-hmm. But to me, it was more of a Wally West Flash than anything
absolutely.
Else.
Absolutely. Yes. I said the same exact thing. And if you want to give us a Wally West Flash, give us a Wally West Flash. Don't right. give us Wally West and call him Barry Allen. That's
correct.
Doing the character a disservice. They're two very different. When Wally was the Flash, it was definitely not Barry Allen. When Jeff Johns got on Rebirth, brought Barry back, just like he did with Hal Jordan with the mm-hmm. Green Lantern he infused that dramatic bravado to the characters, you know what I mean? Because people right. say, oh, you know, it's a superhero, it's a guy in tights, how serious can it be? Well, these characters are like the Greek gods. They're American mythology, like we said before, you know? And right. Yes, they need to be taken seriously. You know, if you Batman, Adam West, that's great. But even there was some good storytelling. You know, I mean, they definitely went heavy on the comedic, and I don't think that's what we need with The Flash. I mean, that's probably no. going to be what we get with Shazam.
Right. But
I think Aquaman, the way Juan handled that, was a perfect balance. And balance is the key. Just like you just said, you know, a character has to have that balance for it to be effective. And I think The Flash, right. even more so than, let's face it, we're probably never going to see a comedic Batman film ever again. And that's a good thing. Mm-hmm. But with The Flash, I think that opens the door to more so than Shazam, Aquaman, Wonder Woman. I think he's a great character to walk that line between darkness and light and give us a really well-balanced script to let him do that. My fear is Ezra Miller, Grant Morrison has written a few episodes of Happy on sci-fi, but both of them are relatively unproven screenwriters. You know, and you're taking a screenplay that's been written from by a guy who has proven himself as a screenwriter. You know, maybe they could get together on this and kind of work something out. Because I think that if Ezra Miller says, I want this script that I wrote with Grant Morrison, I think the studio could balk and we could lose the opportunity to get a Flash movie.
Yeah, I'll say this. I mean, Barry Allen, for as a comic book reader, is not comedy relief. There's definitely never was the intention. This is a character that, again, like you mentioned, had a dark origin. He mm-hmm. was a cop, and as mm-hmm. a cop, even if he's a forensic scientist mm-hmm. working as a police officer or for the police department,
yeah.
you're going to have some dark encounters and some dark stories His rogues gallery, especially with Zoom, very, very dark.
Yeah, so, and even with, more so with the new villains like Godspeed, you know, and Zoom, dark.
Right. The heartbreak with Iris. Everything that's associated with that. And I feel, I know I'm going to get some hate tweets for this, but for as much as I love the Justice League, the animated series,
mm-hmm.
I feel that the portrayal of the Flash there, although it was Wally, warmed everybody up to accept a more comedic or comic relief Flash.
Yeah.
When Barry Allen came back, and that's the other thing, too, you have to consider that the Barry Allen Flash in the comics was gone for a generation.
Yes.
So when they bring him back, it's new for everybody.
Yeah.
Who's just jumping into Flash and like, who the hell's this guy?
Right.
And that he is not, but the way he was portrayed in the movies, it like, you know what it is? They said, you know, we're going to put the Flash on the big screen. With mm-hmm. for the first time with all these other heroes, but we're just going to mix everything in.
No, right.
And I think that Ezra Miller recognized that, listen, you said my name was Barry Allen as the Flash, mm-hmm. but I'm acting like Wally West.
Yeah. And from what I hear about Ezra Miller, he is a really big Flash fan. I mean, he went back and read, you know, all of the legendary runs and, you know, he really dove into, again, not the harp one, but the source material, you know, he dove into it and he, you know, like we as comic fans love Barry Allen and Wally West in two different ways because they're so different, you know, and you're talking about pre-Crisis Barry Allen, and mm-hmm. then, like you said, he's gone for a generation before we get a post-Crisis Barry Allen with Geoff Johns at the helm. All in that other in the interim, we have Wally West, and he brings such a different paradigm. It's a huge paradigm switch when he comes in. You know, he brings in a little bit of the comedic, where you know he has to consume tons of calories after he runs, and right. you know, he's not a CSI, you know, he's a totally, he's younger, you know, so he brings that kind of Peter Parker-esque, just, you know.
You see, and then as you say that, I'll throw this in there because Wally West, okay,
mm-hmm.
you know, he was one of the early sidekicks in the DC universe, but
yeah.
as he got older and grew with the Titans and eventually became a new Teen Titan. This was a guy who was Dick Grayson's best friend.
Yeah.
Who went through some serious issues.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, nothing comedic. In fact, it was during the time of the Crisis on Infinite Earths.
Mm-hmm.
He was extremely depressed. And
oh, yeah. Yes.
He was very intimidated with even being the suggestion even being made to him. Well, Barry's gone. So here you go. You know,
yeah.
this was a character that was portrayed as struggling to accept that the mantle was his.
Yeah.
But yet and he held it down for 30 years.
Yeah. And, you know, he struggled with getting a handle on the Speed Force connection to the Speed Force more so than, you know, Barry, you know, he had the ability and the knowledge to manipulate the Speed Force in such an intelligent and insightful and enlightened way that Wally never had, you know, Wally always, and now that we have Wally and Wallace, you know, it doesn't mm-hmm. make things any easier to get a grip on. If you're you know, a casual reader, that's going to throw you for a loop. Not only the difference between Wally and Barry, but Wally and Wallace, you know, and then you're dealing with a pre-crisis and a post-crisis character. And I think that when you talk about putting Barry Allen on the screen, you have to streamline it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And let the wider audience that maybe just consumes these stories cinematically, let them have a meat and potatoes Barry Allen story. And that doesn't need to, you know, have him making one-liners and quips right. constantly, you right. know, because then we lose who Barry Allen really is. And then you have a generation of people who only know that Flash. And I
agree. They can't just be so quick to oh, wait, that's a bad pun. can't be so quick to just, you know, put out that type of story. But again, I mean, the comic books, when it comes to Flash, is very, very rich in history.
Yeah.
And there's a reason why the characters lasted that long.
Absolutely. And not to mention with, you know, Carmine Infantino and all these great, you know, Neil Adams and guys that, you know, added their little, huge contributions in maybe not, you know, extensive runs, but The Flash to me was always a title that had these just flash, no pun, but these flashes of brilliance. You know what I mean? Right. And
you're trying to steal my thunder, Sean? I mean, the puns, I mean. Oh, wait, that's another bad pun because he was struck by lightning. Oh, God, we're on a roll here.
I know.
So, speaking of iconic characters, we're going to cover one last topic before we close it out for this podcast. Another thing, too, that's been a hot topic on social media, Zack Snyder made comments that, wake up, I'm not going to go through all the expletives, but
yeah,
pretty much saying Batman, he can kill.
Or and to even put a finer point on it, has always killed, according to Correct. Zack Snyder. You know?
Right.
And I'm going to let you go first on this one.
I'll say this, okay? Batman's been around for 80 years. Yes. 80 years is a long time. It's so long that I can't comprehend it because I haven't been alive for 80 years.
Right.
Okay. That's an awfully long time. There's been a multitude of people that have worked on Batman comics.
Yes.
Okay. You also have to factor in the era that Batman is living in. Mm-hmm. Okay. So when he came out in the golden age, you know, the late 30s and the 40s, that's a completely different Batman from the Batman you're getting today.
Absolutely.
And back then, you know, no comics code. It was a free for all. People were like, oh man, you know, Batman, this is hot. They weren't saying hot. Who knows what they used back then?
Probably saying he was the bee's knees or the cat's pajamas.
exactly. But you have to consider that, you know, yes. You know, if you're crime fighting, and you're considered a detective, it's only a matter of time where you're going to be put in a situation where there will be casualties. Now, throughout the years, with Batman, as he evolved, they made him, they refined him a bit, they fixed up the origin, they gave him a sidekick, he became campy, they explored a darker avenue with the Dark Knight, but they felt that, as a human character, you know, he felt that because of what happened to his parents and how it happened and with the tool that was used to murder his parents, that he was like, you know what? That's not me. That's not me at all. And I'm totally against that because it took my parents away.
Uh-huh.
And that's totally okay. And that's been the pretty much the thing for Batman, that he is not into guns and he is not into killing. You know, the villains, the rogues gallery that Batman has is, I mean, they're countless already.
Mm-hmm.
You know, homicidal maniacs and sociopaths and what have you. You know, straight up killers.
Yeah.
And those stories that Batman is, you know, when he's up against these guys, it's a tremendous psychological battle, physical battle to begin with.
Mm-hmm.
But at the end of the day, he could say, you know what? I'm not a killer.
Yeah.
And that's big.
It is. So
I'm not offended either way. You know, but yes, Batman was a killer. There are panels with him holding a gun.
Yeah.
But the way that Batman has evolved, I totally respect that. But to say that, you know, Batman is going to be or should be a killer, to me, it's kind of like we're devolving Batman.
I agree. Well, the way I see it is, Zach, in the big Batman narrative, Zack Snyder is a Johnny come lately,
Yeah. Yep.
His opinion carries way more weight than it should. You know, I mean, you have these people clamoring for the Snyder cut of Justice League, mm-hmm. and clamoring for the Snyder cut of this and the Snyder cut of that. And I'll admit, when I first heard that he was going to be the go-to guy for the DCEU, I loved Watchmen. I thought it was visually stunning. It was gorgeous. It stuck to the source material enough to have some real comic book credibility. And I like the films that I'm a fan of Batman vs. Superman. I like Justice League. I think there are glimpses of greatness in all the work he's done for the for bringing the DC characters to the big screen. But to say this is how Batman is and this is Batman, it's impossible to do. Like you said, he is a product of his environment. He's a product of the times. The stories are the culmination of real life events, trends in fiction of the time. You have great writers, great artists. You have Marshall Rogers, and at one time, all of the Batman stories. If you look at Detective in the late 60s, early 70s, they wanted him to be a creature of the night. It's when he went back to the giant.
It coincided with all the horror books that were coming about in that time. Yeah.
Right. Like Swamp Thing and
Man-Bat was introduced. Yeah.
Yeah. And the tremendous artwork of Bernie Wrightson and guys like that were so steeped in like EC sensibility.
Right.
There was a lot of that bleeding into maybe not Batman proper as much, but certainly Detective. And so Batman's been around for 80 years. For being around 80 years, he has a relatively, I'll say extremely low body count,
Right.
There are arcs. There was a miniseries that Neil Adams did where Batman carried a gun. There are the early stories in Detective and even early Batman stories where
I remember Batman Year, one of the Batman Year 2 covers.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And the McFarlane covers,
right.
They were
early
so
McFarlane. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Beautiful covers with the orange backgrounds that just made that blue costume just pop right off. And certainly gun violence played a huge role in the Year 2 narrative. And, I think that Batman's relationship with guns is an intimate one because of how his parents were taken out of the world by gun violence. And I think that Ben Affleck's take on Batman was a particularly brutal one. Mm-hmm. I think it really was. I liked it. I didn't necessarily think that this is everyone's Batman, but if you put a gun in that character's hand, it diminishes him, and I don't think to say Batman kills and he's always killed. Okay, maybe he overdoes it. He mm-hmm. Like you said, he's dealing with guys that were once his ally, with Harvey Dent, who is now his enemy. Mm-hmm. Guys that that were once Jason Todd, now once time being a villainous Red Hood, now of course mm-hmm. He's back on the side of good, but these characters are multifaceted characters. You to say Batman is a killer, and it's not that black and white.
No, definitely not. And you know, one thing I will say, there are panels and recent ones at that where Batman will say, I am known to be one of the top shots in the world.
Oh,
in the DC universe. There's no doubt about it. So he's no stranger to knowing how to use a weapon. He's not afraid of it, of course, because, you know, it's just facing villains like Deadshot, for Christ's sake. But,
we know that he's an absolute he is an absolute Deadshot because of when he uses the batarang gun, the launcher. He never misses, you know. So obviously he's trained.
He knows how to handle weapons. That's fine and everything. It's hard without stepping, it's like stepping on eggshells with this topic, but I'm more comfortable personally. I'm much more comfortable with a Batman that is not intimidated, is not unfamiliar with the use of handguns or any weapons in general.
Yeah.
But when it comes at the end of the day, knowing that he has, doesn't kill, he has had body counts, but that's just the reality of it, especially in the early days. But as we progress through time, the body count is non-existent.
Right.
But to change that or to suggest that is just, like you said, it diminishes what Batman means. And I just think that having that type of challenge or that adversity that he faces with the rogues gallery that he has, who kill with like nobody's business.
Oh, yeah.
It's like, they have a higher body count than the burgers that are flipped at a fast food joint.
Oh, the Joker alone has probably...
Exactly. So the fact that he's going up against guys like that and yet somehow finds it within himself to say that at the end of the day, justice has to prevail.
Mm-hmm.
For a guy who is ultimately human with no superpowers and at setting an example for other heroes within the Justice League, that's Batman to me.
Yeah. And he, like you said, within the Justice League, his reputation is it's already like, this guy jumps to physical violence too quickly. He already is painted in that light. So to put a gun in his hand, I mean, what are we going to see him walking around with a sidearm? That's not Batman.
No.
The fact that, I keep thinking of this particular scene, which is not Batman, but Star Wars, when Luke Skywalker has the chance and the opportunity to cut down Darth Vader with his lightsaber right there, and he turns it off and throws it and says, I'm not like that. I'm a Jedi like my father. Batman has done that constantly to say, look, I could kill this guy right now, but I don't do that.
I can recollect the scene in the Justice League animated series when Darkseid came to Earth towards the end and Lex Luthor has a hand weapon with all the parademons running around them. And he says to Batman, he offers him his gun and Batman's like, it's not my style. And to that's just the epitome of what Batman is.
Yes.
He doesn't need it.
No. And, he's the world's greatest detective, and he's the Dark Knight. He's all these things that are higher ideals than to say, I'm just going to shoot this guy in the face and end it. You know what I mean? There's always a higher ideal at work with Batman. And I think that is the poetic beauty of the character. You know what I mean? He's born of tragedy, born of darkness. That scene when the bat flies through the window in year one, the Mazzucchelli panel it's one of my favorite panels of all time. And I think when you see Bruce Wayne in that chair slumped down and that bat flies through the window and it all comes together for him, I don't think that killing people was part of that idea that he had at that point in time.
Oh, I absolutely agree. Absolutely. I don't need to use a gun, but if you're under the age of 13, come to the Batcave. I could always use another Robin to do my dirty work.
As long as you don't have an aversion to crowbars.
Yeah, exactly. Oh yeah.
Or bring a helmet.
Exactly. But yeah, it's an interesting thing that it just causes such a stir, and I just think that it, at the end of the day, it's kind of sad that this even comes out on the week of Batman's technical 80th anniversary week.
Absolutely. I was disappointed to see it, and I think that for me, as someone who kind of was sitting on the fence about Zack Snyder, it kind of made me fall down on the side of, you know what, maybe this guy isn't the best guy to be involved in bringing these characters to the screen if he doesn't have that firm of a grasp on, you know, quite possibly the most iconic comic book character of all time.
I couldn't agree more. All right, so that'll do it for our Capes podcast today. And again, I'm going to be a lazy host again, and I'm going to allow Sean to do his own plug-in before we end the show.
All right. anybody that wants to follow me on Twitter at Sean Warner 629, you can follow me there. Definitely go to Comic Crusaders and check out my reviews, along with everybody else who contributes their time and talent to such a great website that's all about spreading the love of comic books without any political or side agendas, just strictly for the love of comics. Check us out. And with that, I'll turn it back over to my good friend, the 13th Crusader.
Oh, he said the word good friend. You better watch out. You're going to get some hate tweets for that. definitely check us out on Undercover Capes. We're all over social media. Definitely check out Comic Crusaders, as Sean said. You can follow me on Twitter if you want, at 13th Crusader on Twitter. Definitely tweet us at UCTheCapes as well. We're always going to post a new poll question. You guys did a very phenomenal job with the comments and voting on the Joe Sinnott stuff. Definitely. So thank you for that. Any suggestions, comments, whatever you have, definitely send it our way. And on that note, again, thank you so much for tuning in, and we will catch you next time.
Excelsior!
Hasta la vista! You think I wasn't going to put Arnold in here? You got to guess wrong. Thank you for listening to The Capes. Be sure to follow us on Facebook and Twitter at UCTheCapes, and also check out our website at undercovercapes.com.